Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is once again Todd Wilkins' guest on Issues, Etc. They're discussing the ongoing saga of the Ruth Institute being terminated by their online payment processing service because of their inclusion on the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map.
Children are entitled to a relationship with both of their parents, and they're entitled to know who they are.
Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse of the Ruth Institute talking about her presentation at the 2017 Fall Issues, Etc. Making the Case Conference.
And if you take that entitlement as basic and reason backwards from that, what you'll end up with is the whole traditional Christian sexual morality. Get married, stay married, and only have sex with the person you're married to.
You can meet and hear Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse making the case against the sexual revolution at the Fall Issues, Etc. Making the Case Conference, Friday, November 10th and Saturday, November 11th in Houston, Texas. Registration is $120 and includes three meals. Child care is free. For more information, look for the Making the Case logo at issuesetc.org or call 618-223-8385. The Issues, Etc. Making the Case Conference, November 10th and 11th in Houston.
Trump says you must be able to speak language English, qualified, and have a job skill. Jesus would not qualify to come in Trump's country, and he would not qualify to get in Jesus' kingdom.
Wherever you have polytheism, you have cultures, you have this fractured understanding of God where he's splintered up into all these different beings, you always have a lowering of ethical and moral standards as well.
I can come to the scriptures with humility, knowing that I can err, but I ought to have the confidence that the truth of God's word can be known there and that I can in fact know it.
Stay-at-home moms, antiquarian enthusiasts, some sensual Cali, loves, issues, etc. Can you see the fish?
Yeah, I can see the fish. It's right there.
The pressure's been on for, well, about 5 years from the corporate world. It came quickly. How did that change? How did the corporate boardroom go from worrying about the bottom line to social activism to cutting-edge activism on behalf of the sexual revolution, where you had, what was it, Brandon Eich was fired from Mozilla, if I'm not mistaken, because he'd given what? I mean, in terms of his tax bracket, a paltry sum to support natural marriage in California. And that was it. And then it was a small-time person, the baker, the anybody involved in the wedding service is now a target, florists, big and small. And now apparently it has to do with whether or not you can use online payment services, processing services. They're dropping some organizations because, well, at least one of them has ended up on the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map. Have you seen this hate map? Greetings and welcome to Issues, Etc., coming to you live from the studios of Lutheran Public Radio in Collinsville, Illinois. I'm Todd Wilkin. Thanks for tuning us in. We're going to be talking to Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse of the Ruth Institute. This pro-family organization, she's a regular guest, by the way, was dropped by an online payment service for being labeled as a hate group by the Southern Poverty Law Center. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She's senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute, and she's author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Dr. Morse, welcome back to Issues, Etc.
Hey, Todd, thanks for having me on.
I had seen this last week sometime that the Ruth Institute had been snubbed by an online donation service based upon the fact, and this was the first time I heard this, that the Ruth Institute ended up somehow on the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map. What is this map, and Do you have a problem in principle with people just not wanting to do business with the Ruth Institute based upon your positions on marriage and family?
Well, Todd, I have no problem with people wanting to do business only with the people they want to do business with. I mean, I'd be shocked if somebody gave me a donation or invited me to speak at their place if they didn't agree with what I had to say. You know, that would be shocking. But what is surprising is that people who disagree with certain positions get the hate group label slapped on them. And, you know, Todd, you're really slipping. If you didn't know we were a hate group, we've been on that list of the Southern Poverty Law Center. We've been on that list since 2013, man. And I don't think anybody's done any violent acts as a result of our teachings or anything, but, you know, there you go.
All right, let's talk about, if we could, I looked at the hate map, and among groups that I don't think even belong on the list, there are some groups that I think would qualify as hate groups. Does the Ruth Institute, or other groups for that matter, that are simply advocating for natural marriage and the like, do they belong on a list with Ku Klux Klan groups and neo-Nazi groups?
Well, Todd, I'll let one of my board members speak to that question. We have on our board is Reverend Walter Hoy, who's an African-American pastor who's very active in the pro-life movement. And he was interviewed by the Washington Times on exactly this point. Walter's great-grandfather was lynched by the Ku Klux Klan. And Walter is saying, you know, look, there is no way the Ruth Institute belongs on this list. The Ruth Institute is trying to rebuild the black family, trying to rebuild all families. There's just no way it belongs on the same list. So I think the reason we end up on that list is that some of the people who advocate for the deconstruction of the family really cannot defend their positions very well. And so as a strategic matter, as a tactical matter, they like to position us next to people with white hoods and swastikas so that nobody has to listen to us anymore. That excuses them from the necessity of needing to actually respond to what we have to say about why family breakdown is harmful to people, and in particular, why removing the gender requirement from marriage is not going to be a good thing for society and certainly not for children. So that's the origin of how we ended up there, you know, that if you disagree with the gay lobby, then you are defaming people and you amount to the Ku Klux Klan. That's how that happened. But it's, of course, completely unjustified.
So what happened as a consequence of this with this online donation service and the Ruth Institute?
Well, you know, we received last week, less than a week ago, actually, last Thursday, we received an email at 2:00 in the afternoon saying that the Vanco company, which processes our online donations, and they market themselves to Christian organizations, by the way, that's why we, you know, signed up with them. We received an email from them at 2:00 in the afternoon saying, you know, we've decided we don't want to do business with you anymore. I forget their exact language. We have it in our press release, which people can find on the Ruth Institute website and also on our Ruth Institute Facebook page. But basically they said, you've been flagged as being a group that promotes hate, violence, or abuse or harassment, I think were the four things they said. And so therefore, we're going to stop doing business with you as of August 31st. Well, last Thursday was August 31st. We went and looked at our website, and it was already taken down. Already, our credit card processing had already been removed. So obviously, they took it down before they even notified us that they had an issue with us. So that's the sum total of what I know about them and their thinking.
Now, I'm curious here. You said that this is due to the fact that groups that advocate for really kind of the extremes of the sexual revolution, even the mainstream of the sexual revolution, are unable to support their positions. So
Yes. They
simply label the opposition, like the Ruth Institute, to silence them. Expand on that, if you would.
Well, you know, Todd, you guys at Issues of Set, et cetera, have been so good to us, and you have been so generous with your time in terms of allowing us to explain our position. So I'm very grateful to you and all of your listeners, because obviously your listeners like us. I hear from them all the time. But so the sexual revolution is irrational, Todd. You know, the sexual revolution is based on three points that are simply untrue. You know, the first point is that sex is an intrinsically sterile activity, and everybody is free to act however they want on the assumption that no live baby is ever going to result from your sex life. Well, of course, that's not true. Sex does make babies, okay? So that's point one. Secondly, the second point is that both sex and babies can safely be removed from marriage because kids are so resilient that it doesn't matter whether the parents are married or not. And so, therefore, adults are entitled to any sex life they want, and the children just have to accept whatever arrangements the adults happen to come up with for them. Well, that's unbelievably false. I mean, that's undeniably false. Children suffer tremendously when their parents shift around their relationships and leave the old parent behind, you know, and the kids have to live between two households and adjust to new relationships, new step-siblings, and all the rest of it. It's enormously disruptive and harmful to children. So that point of the sexual revolution is also false. And then the final point of the sexual revolution is that maleness and femaleness are socially constructed things, and we can socially reconstruct them any way we want. And in fact, an individual can reconstruct their gender using a combination of technology and cultural conditioning. A person can reconstruct their sexual identity because the sex of the body is not really very significant. And that too is false. Men and women actually are different. Those differences amount to something. And attempting to build a whole society around the idea that men and women are interchangeable, it's impossible. So all three of these points are completely impossible. And so in order to move forward the sexual revolutionary agenda, the only choice you have is to tell everybody to sit down and shut up, you know. So it's not, this didn't just start the day before yesterday with the Human Rights Campaign or something. This has been going on for a long time. Abortion opponents have been told for a long time to shut up. Men have been told for a long time that they are male chauvinist pigs if they have any objections to any of this. And most tragically of all, the children of divorce have been told that they need to sit down and shut up and that they're the ones with the problem, not the parents, not the society. And so, you know, we're just hurtling down this track further and further, and it's getting crazier and crazier. And so the techniques that they're coming up with are more and more radical and harder to defend if you take even the slightest step outside the ideology and look at it objectively.
Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is our guest on this Wednesday, September the 6th. We're talking about a pro-family organization dropped by an online payment service for being labeled as a hate group. When we come back, how do you go from simply disagreeing about natural marriage to being labeled a hate group? Welcome back to Issues Etc. I'm Todd Wilkin. We're talking about a pro-family organization dropped by an online payment service for being labeled as a hate group. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is our guest, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, the organization in question. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason University. She's senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. And she'll be making the case against the sexual revolution at the 2017 Fall Issues Etc. Making the Case Conference in Houston, Texas. Jen will be joined by Mark and Molly Hemingway, Rod Dreher, Dr. Scott Murray, and Pastor Brian Wolfmiller. Child care at the conference is free due to the Consortium for Classical Lutheran Education. Attendance is limited to 400. You can register by check. Just download and fill out a registration form at issuesetc.org. You can also register online at our website, the 2017 Making the Case Conference, Friday, November 10th and Saturday, November 11th in Houston, Texas. So, Jennifer, how do you get from the Ruth Institute is wrong on natural marriage, we disagree with it, to the Ruth Institute is a hate group? How is that leap made?
Well, if you think back to the campaign to redefine marriage, you know, what you'll see if you look back is that disagreeing with the policy proposal became synonymous with bigotry and with hatred. Okay, so that process, it's been going on for a while, and I think they did it for two reasons. I mean, I think there's sort of two prongs to this. I mean, I hesitate to say that I know what their thought process is, because, you know, they need to speak for themselves if they want to explain themselves. But this is what I'm surmising from how they're behaving, that on the one hand, they very much want to use the whole civil rights infrastructure that already exists, and that exists based on the experience of African Americans. So they want to be able to say, you're a bigot if you don't agree with us, because and it's a civil rights issue. Gay marriage is a civil rights issue, because then all the discrimination law, all the civil rights law, that can all be pressed into service, you know, pretty much ready-made. And so that's a big part of why they wanted to argue that people are born that way. It's an immutable characteristic. It's just like race, so on and so forth. So the irony to that, Todd, is that African-Americans, if you kicked out an average African-American on the street and asked them what they think of gay marriage, they would be closer to the Ruth Institute's position than they would be to the Human Rights Campaign's position. No question about it. You know, Black Americans voted in favor of man-woman marriage in California by the largest majority of any ethnic group. So that's the big irony to this whole thing.
Now, I guess what I'm wondering is, if it could happen to the Ruth Institute, you are a very innocuous group.
Thank you.
I think it was. I looked at your website. I was looking for, you know, some kind of signaling of hatred or a call to arms against someone. Didn't find anything at all, Jennifer. So if it could happen to the sweet little Ruth Institute, it could happen to just about anybody, couldn't it?
Oh, well, I think that's right. I think that's exactly right. And it will. I mean, if it can happen to me, it can happen to your church. If VANCO, which markets itself to Christian organizations, will cut off the Ruth Institute, why wouldn't they cut off Missouri Synod Lutheran Churches? Because your position is closer to mine than to the Human Rights Campaign or the Southern Poverty Law Center's view, right? That's why you keep inviting me on your program, which is very nice of you. But yeah, any pastor listening to us who uses this organization as their donation processing server should be aware, you know, that this is possible, that this could happen to them. So, yeah, people need to be aware of it, and we need to get off the sidelines and take some action here.
You are quoted in the press. It says, Morse concluded that she respects the right of VANCO, card brands, and Wells Fargo to conduct their business as they see fit, since they are private entities. Then they quote you, we just wish wedding photographers, bakers, and florists receive the same respect. What are you talking about there?
Well, what I'm talking about is the fact that wedding photographers, florists, bakers, these kinds of groups that market to weddings and that serve weddings have been brought up under human rights charges or anti-discrimination charges for the fact that they stand for the traditional definition of marriage. And in fact, there's an important case that's working its way towards the Supreme Court that has to do with the baker in exactly this situation. So, you know, if the rule is going to be that anybody can cease to do business with anybody they want for any reason they want, I don't see why that rule shouldn't apply equally to the Christian wedding photographer as much as it applies to VANCO and Wells Fargo.
Someone might wonder, these aren't just, you know, small private organizations. Wells Fargo is a big financial institution. What has happened to corporate America, maybe the corporate American boardroom, that has brought about such a rapid shift in its viewpoint, now a hostility, an open hostility toward those who advocate for natural marriage?
Yes, that is a very interesting question. But, you know, if you look at a lot of corporate America, you will see Wells Fargo, for example, has been financing gay pride parades for some time, you know, and many big corporations support Planned Parenthood, for example. So from that respect, you can see corporate America has kind of already drunk the Kool-Aid of the sexual revolution some time ago. The real question is, why? What's in it for them? And I think Well, there are a couple of possible answers to that. One is that the sexual revolution has actually kind of benefited corporate America because they get workers who are unencumbered by babies quite so much. The idea is, women are supposed to be out there working on the same terms as men. In order for that to happen, you have to sterilize the sexual act. You have to have the sexual act under control. And that means that women are under pressure to postpone childbearing. So I think that's part of it. But the other part of it, Todd, is that if you think about it, postponing childbearing is the entry condition for getting into any of the professions. All the professions require education and training and all of that. You're going to be almost 30 by the time you're able to really start making money and paying off your student debt and so on and so forth. If that's the case, then that means that the people who are occupying positions of power and authority, the people who are being newscasters, the people in law firms, the people who are CEOs, those kind of people have put off childbearing, whether they're men or women increasingly. They've put off childbearing. And how did they do that? They did it using contraception and abortion. And so many of those people are deeply, deeply committed personally to the tenets of the sexual revolution. So I think that's a big part of what we're up against.
Then the tipping point comes with, as my colleague has once pointed out, it just takes one member of your board to be an activist for now the cutting edge of the sexual revolution. And it sounds like the ground is already fertile for that to take root in a corporate boardroom.
Yes, I think that's right. And we saw this a few years ago with one of the foundations trying to cut off their donations to Planned Parenthood. There was one person who was saying, I think it was what was the Komen Foundation? I forget what it was, but the whole boardroom of that organization was committed to giving money to Planned Parenthood, and it was one poor person standing there saying, "Hey, wait, why are we doing this?" And she was completely drowned out by the chorus inside there. So it's in many cases, Todd, it's more than just one person on the board advocating the sexual revolution. In many cases, it's pretty well dominant.
Finally, then, do you have any idea how you get the Ruth Institute off the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map?
I have no earthly idea. Since I don't know how we got on it, I don't really know how we get off of it. But I do know that people who are fed up with this kind of thing need to help us. And any of your listeners who care to write a letter to any of these organizations, you can do that. If you subscribe to our newsletter, which is very easy to do, sign up for our newsletter. You subscribe to our newsletter. This week, we give instructions on how you can correspond with some of these people and tell them what you think. I don't know that I have no illusion that we're going to get off that map just because a few people write letters, but it's absolutely time for your listeners to donate to the Ruth Institute, to sign up for our newsletter, and to tell your friends to do likewise and to support us in every way you can.
Folks, you can find out more about this story on the Ruth Institute at our website, issuesetc.org. Click Listen on Demand. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is founder and president of the Ruth Institute. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities. She's senior research fellow in economics for the Acton Institute and author of several books, including her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Jennifer, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Listening to Dr. J and Todd Wilkin discussing the Ruth Institute's termination by their online payment processing service because of their inclusion on the Southern Poverty Law Center's hate map on Issues, etc. At the beginning of the podcast, Todd mentioned Issues' annual Making the Case conference. Check out our website for registration details. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. And we're also on Facebook, like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.